In this video, we'll see Nusselt number correlations for flow past circular geometries, that is, external flow past cylinders and spheres. For cross flow over a cylinder, we'll first look at how the momentum boundary layer develops and what are the key features of the momentum boundary layer. So in this picture, the flow comes through in this direction and goes past the cylinder and goes this way. Now, if you look at the velocity profile here, at initially, if the fluid, cylinder were not there, it would have been a straight flow. Now, this entire flow that would have come here is now directed towards here. So this region is of the highest pressure, and pressure decreases along this direction. So because there is pressure decreasing, the flow has an accelerated motion. The velocity here is zero, and then that this point is called a stagnation point, and the velocity increases as we go along the theta direction from here to here. So the flow here is accelerating. Then past this 90 degrees, there is a decrease in pressure. Because pressure, there's an increase in pressure. Because there's an increase in pressure, the pressure downstream is higher than the pressure upstream, the fluid packets will be decelerating. And at some point, the fluid particles will be decelerated to velocity zero, and the flow will change direction. So the flow particles, which the packets of fluid which are going this direction, will reach zero velocity and then reverse the direction of flow. So this point at which the flow reverses is called as the separation point, or the boundary layer which was attached to this till here. At this point, it separates. So the boundary layer flow, the mean flow and the boundary layer, in fact, looks like this. So there is a negative direction velocity here, and then it goes to zero and then goes to positive this side. So if you imagine this boundary layer to be this one, and this line to be the dashed line is of zero velocity. So the boundary layer was attached to the surface and gets detached here. So this is called as separation of the boundary layer. It happens in cylinders and in spheres. What happens after that? In this region, there is a lot of recirculation. And this recirculation are known as vortices. And when the Reynolds number is very high, it could also become turbulent. Depending on the nature of the flow, laminar or turbulent, the separation point can change from here to here. For laminar flow, the flow separation actually occurs slightly below. For lower Reynolds number, the separation point is not after 90 degrees, but before 90 degrees because of other variations in the pressure here. So for lower Reynolds number, the separation point occurs at 80 degrees, which is somewhere here. For very high Reynolds numbers, the boundary layer is more attached. The boundary layer is attached till a very large distance, that is up to about 140 degrees. So in contrast to the normal intuition, one would think that the boundary layer for turbulent gets detached quickly. But on the other hand, the flow is impressed upon the surface because of very high velocities, and it continues to retain attached to the surface for high Reynolds number. Whereas for low Reynolds number, it detaches earlier. Now, depending on this separation point, depends on the Reynolds. It also depends on the roughness of the surface. Now, a classical example is that of a golf ball versus a table tennis ball. A golf ball is kept rough, whereas a table tennis ball is smooth. The reason why a golf ball is kept rough is because when you have a rough surface, the boundary layer separates at a farther angle. In this region, called as the wake region, the pressure is nearly zero because it's in a recirculating, there is no streamline flow here. Because separation for a turbulent flow is at a larger angle, which is at an angle here, the wake region is narrower in the turbulent region compared to the laminar region. So laminar region has got a higher wake than the turbulent region. Now the drag force felt by the motion of this particle is actually the difference in the pressure between here and here. In the case of laminar region, this entire region has got zero pressure, and here it is the maximum pressure. So the total pressure in the laminar flow is, pressure difference in laminar flow is higher than the pressure difference here. In the case of turbulent flow, because the flow separates, the flow is, boundary layer is attached here, the pressure on this side is cancelled by the pressure on this side. So the total net force acting on the sphere is only on this area, whereas here it is zero, here it is a finite. So the net pressure, net force acting on the spherical particle is lower in the case of turbulent flow. And that is why a rough sphere such as the golf ball can travel a larger distance with less drag. Let us see an animation of this motion. Here we see the motion of particles showing the motion of fluid. Now, this is a laminar flow. Notice that here it is all uniform, but then here suddenly the flow reverses. So when the flow reverses, the particle motion also changes. So in this case, the flow separation occurs somewhere here. In this video, we'll see the motion of particles in a turbulent flow compared to the laminar flow. In laminar flow, you will notice that the wake region is very large because separation is here and here, whereas in the turbulent flow, the separation occurs here and here and the wake region is small. So you'll notice that the particle continues to have velocities along here, and somewhere here is where it reverses the direction. Whereas in the case of laminar, the reversal happens somewhere at this point. And therefore, the wake region for laminar flow is much higher, effectively making this pressure difference large, and therefore the drag force coming from laminar flow is much large compared to the drag force of the turbulent flow. Now let's look at the Nusselt number variation for in the boundary layer for flow over a cylinder. So what is plotted here is a Nusselt number versus the angular coordinate theta, which goes from 0 to 180. Now these are lines for different Reynolds number. This is for a low Reynolds number, 500, 10 power 4, 10 power 5, and 10 power 6. All of them show a different qualitative behavior. At low Reynolds number, which is this, the Nusselt number monotonously decreases. So that is the typical expectation of Nusselt number as when for low Reynolds. So as the theta increases, the Nusselt number also decreases. Now, we can, based on this nature of this thing, we can identify three regions. The first region is a laminar region where the Nusselt number always decreases. That is, from theta is equal to 0 till about 90, depending on the Reynolds number, the Nusselt number always decreases. In the second region, which is in the vortex or in the wake region, because of mixing, the Nusselt number actually increases. In the third region, which is in the transition region, so from laminar to turbulent region transition, the Nusselt number shows a double minima. So there is first minima which decreases here, then it increases, and then again it decreases. So this is in the transition region. And finally, in the turbulent region, the Nusselt number again increases. So this all dependence is because of the way the boundary layer separates. Now let's look at, this was just an introduction to, qualitative introduction to various phenomena that are going on. Now, for practical applications, it is actually very simple. We just need to go and look at correlations for corresponding geometries and their exponents and prefactors. In the case of flow past a cylinder, the general expression is C times Re power m Pr power 1 by 3. Now, depending on the Reynolds number, this exponent m and the prefactor C vary from nearly 1 to about 0.3. That is Reynolds number of 0.4 to 10 power 5. And the exponent also goes from 0.33 for this and till about 0.8. Now, the same expression, generic expression, can also can be used for non-circular cross sections, but could be pipes or channels which are having square, rhombus, hexagon, or hexagon with a sharp end facing the flow. Now, in all these cases, C and M have been experimentally evaluated. So, all these things are experimentally evaluated. There are no analytical expressions for these. Flow past a sphere is also very similar to flow past a cylinder. As we saw in the video example, it was for a sphere. So, there is a flow separation, there is a laminar to transition to turbulence, and the average Nusselt number is given like this. In most of, there's nothing to remember, we just need to go and look up at the formulas and find out at what temperature the properties are evaluated. That is very important. So when the experiments were performed, these are all experimental results. So when the experiment are performed, the properties are measured at some specified temperature. We just need to find out at what temperatures they were measured and then use the same correlations for our application. In this particular case, all the properties except mu s is evaluated at the temperature of the free stream. Mu s is the surface temperature, viscosity at the surface temperature, which is very close to the surface of the object. Now, the expression for Nusselt number for sphere is qualitatively different from that of the cylinder, in that there is a constant. So this constant plus some factor. In the case of Nusselt number for a cylinder, there was no constant. When Reynolds number became 0, Nusselt number also becomes 0. Whereas for sphere, one can recover when Reynolds number goes to 0, Nusselt number actually becomes a constant. Same thing applies even for mass transfer, where the Sherwood number becomes 2. The meaning of this is that, and when Reynolds number becomes 0, convection is 0 and there is pure conduction. And the pure conduction heat transfer coefficient, we have in fact derived this in while studying two-dimensional heat transfer. So two-dimensional heat transfer for a sphere, we get a factor, which is a shape factor, from which we can derive Nusselt number to be. Finally, for there are applications where instead of having a single flow past a
flow past a single cylinder, we could have a bank of cylinders or a collection of cylinders, as it usually happens in heat exchangers. In heat exchangers, where fluid, there is one fluid that goes cross and one fluid that goes through this pipe. So through this pipe is an internal flow, across the pipes is external flow. Now, in all these cases, there are standard correlations available. But one interesting point about this correlations is that when the number of rows of these tubes is greater than about 20, then the number of tubes does not come into picture, and the Nusselt number correlation does not have the number of tubes. It becomes independent of the number of tubes. It only depends on the configuration of arrangement, whether it is in straight row or it's like a square lattice or a BCC lattice and so on. One important thing to remember in these calculations is that the Reynolds number that comes in this expression is written as RE max, which is evaluated at the maximum velocity. So the maximum velocity will occur depending on the arrangement of this stacked tubes. So in some case, it will be the closest distance between these both objects where the maximum velocity will occur. So depending on the geometry, you have to first evaluate the maximum velocity first and then the corresponding Reynolds number. To summarize, for circular geometries, the heat transfer coefficient strongly depends on the way momentum boundary layer separates, that the fluid flow boundary layer separates, and the boundary layer separates due to adverse pressure gradients, and that leads to vortex formation turbulence. And in the case of vortices or the wakes and turbulence, they lead to a higher Nusselt number. One important thing to remember while using the formulas is that we need to find the properties at appropriate temperatures at which the experiments were conducted. Thank you.